God is strong. to hear your still small voice again. Holy, righteous, faithful to the waiting here patiently to hear your still small voice again. Holy, righteous, faithful, faithful to the end. Savior, healer, redeemer. Hey, I will worship you for. God, my healer, God, my deliverer.
Give him praise. Give him praise. Give him praise. Everybody says, nobody
like.
Is there anybody like our God? He's the Alpha and Omega. Everybody says, when the oceans rise
and thunders roar,
I will soar with you.
Find the
be still and see the work of Yahweh. No, I will be still, yeah. Oh, lift up your voice, lift up your hands when the oceans rise. Still this morning, oh God, and acknowledge you for who you are, for what you are, oh God. We will acknowledge you because we know indeed that you are the King of all kings. We understand, my Father, that you are the Lord of all lords. You are the great and mighty God. You are the one who speaks and none can refute, oh God. Father, we give you all the glory this morning. We give you all our worship. We give you all the honor because all the honor is due to your name. Take preeminence in this place, O God. Occupy the space which only you can occupy, O God. Be our Father, be our King, be our Creator, O God. These are things that you already are, but we just acknowledge you once again. Thank you, gracious Father. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we have worshiped and prayed. Amen. Good morning, church. You may please be seated. Welcome to church. It's lovely to see you all this morning. It's a great day to be in the presence of the Lord. If you're joining us online, thank you for sharing your space, your time with us. Stay plugged in. It's going to be a wonderful time. Understand that even though you're far away, you are here. And the blessings which are available to us in here will also be available to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Can we have the video announcements, please?
Welcome to another awesome time together in fellowship and celebration at this present house. I'm Oyinsole Joe, and today we'd like to start by giving special recognition to everyone who's joining us for the first time. We have a lot planned for you. After this service, please join our pastors at the red carpet area for a special reception arranged to receive you.
Yes.
With a melody. Surround me with a song of deliverance.
Walk in the light of the prophecies that have gone ahead of you. So if a word is spoken concerning you, reflect it as you move. The concentration of it will happen in your heart. The congregation of it will come together in your heart, but it will soon be evident in your body.
I really believe that talent is overrated and that the people who succeed in life are people who are willing to work harder than everybody else, and that if you work harder than everybody else, you become smarter than everybody else. And then people say you're lucky, but then, you know, I'd rather make my own luck. And I found that the harder I work, the luckier I seem to get. It is impossible to beat a business model that is free. So even in your own lives, when you're putting business models together, always remember that. The business model of today and the business model of the future is one that is built on a free model.
Now, let's take a look at what's ahead of us this week. The April edition of the monthly ladies' meeting comes up this Tuesday morning at the Dome. It starts at 9 a.m. So ladies, let's not forget to come expectant and also invite your family and friends. On Wednesday night, we'll all be back here for midweek service, but this time it's going to be something different. Let's find out what's in store.
This Wednesday, April 13th, it's going to be a special question and answer edition of Relationship Wednesday. We'll have Pastor Dell and Amanda Balogun sharing on the art of marriage. Single or married, doesn't matter. There's something for everyone. On Wednesday the 20th, we'll focus on prayer as Pastor Lemuel George joins us at the Dome for a teaching on prayer. Finally, on Wednesday, the 27th of April, One Music will lead us in a worship experience alongside Modeli, Myro Essay, Tim Godfrey, Tosin Martin, Susie Aliu, and many more. Team is New Nation. All services start at 6:30 p.m. here at the Dome. Mark your calendars and plan to attend.
Our home fellowship Be At One returns on Sunday, April 24th. We have locations spread across the island. So if you are wondering which is closest to you, just stop by the information desk after the service. Our fantastic choir, One Music, have auditions coming up very soon. For anyone who is musically gifted, this is your chance to be a part of one of the best music teams in Nigeria. Don't hesitate to sign up at the information desk after today's service. Now remember that there are different ways to keep up with all the information around here. Just join our online community, find out more on our website, www.thispresenthouse.org. That's all on the TPH update. Good morning, church.
Okay, does someone think I should be doing a special number? Why is there a mic stand here? Can I have a lectern, please? Good morning once again, church. Just want to take a few announcements before Pastor Tony comes up, just because we might not have time to do them at the end. This coming Tuesday is the ladies' monthly meeting, here at the Dome. So Tuesday morning at 9 o'clock, we will be here. Please invite friends. It's not a denominational service. Thank you. It's not a denominational service, so everyone is invited. Can you please ensure that we spread the word and let other people also come and share the benefits of the qualities that we have in this house. So the ladies' meeting, Tuesday, 12th of April, 9 a.m. Next Sunday is Family Sunday. Let's put our hands together for that. We know it's Family Sunday, but we don't talk about it that much, but it is Family Sunday. It's a time when we celebrate family, when we have our dedications of our children, when we celebrate birthdays. So if you have any children to dedicate and stuff like that, please come to the information desk after the service and take a form, and we'll be ready for you for next Sunday. And ministering next Sunday at 8 and 10 a.m. will be Mrs. Rapu. So I'm personally looking forward to that. We can also appreciate God for that. This coming Wednesday, like it said in the video, is a Relationship Wednesday with the two guest ministers. 6:30 p.m. It's the themed, The Art of Marriage. I can't wait because I have a lot to learn on marriage. So I'm looking forward to this Wednesday. But it's going to be a fun time. It's going to be a great time. God always has something in store for his people. So let's look forward to that and let's come expectant. Finally, the King Solomon's Business Academy is starting a four-week program. But let me please invite Pastor Ayo. I did to join me and take this announcement. Pastor Ayo, thank you. Okay, use my mic.
Thank you. Good morning, church. Right. As you know, we've been having these business
We've had business Wednesdays. Who was here last Wednesday? Was it worth it? Okay. Now, we recognize, and a number of people have approached me to ask whether we can run courses that will help people actually kickstart these ideas of theirs. So we've put together a four-week, six-course Kingdom School Business Academy course. It's going to be starting in a few weeks' time. I know in the announcements last week, it had a link that people were supposed to connect to register, and I gather the link hasn't been working. So today we'll be at the back after the service taking registrations for people that want to attend. So it's a four-week course. It's covering six subject areas. At the end of the four-week course, people will be assigned mentors for the next 6 months to actually walk them through getting their business off the ground. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor Ayo. So 4 weeks, I understand Pastor Tony will be taking some of these teachings on the on kingdom businesses. And I think I've got the link here. If we have a link on media, can you put it up, please? That's it, yes. www.thispresenthouse.org/KSBA. KSBA stands for King Solomon's Business Academy. So www.thispresenthouse.org/KSBA. If you want to join the choir, we're still interested in new enrollments. Please stop at the music desk. The information desk and pick up a form. Also, we are still looking for people who will give up their homes to host the Be At One. That's our house fellowship program. If you're interested, also please stop by at the music desk. Information desk. I just did that again.
Hello, good morning, everyone. The fewer crises get, a little better, isn't it? So why don't you be encouraged? Why is everyone so quiet today? You're just sort of feeling low today. Okay, let's worship the Lord then. You unravel me with a melody. You surround song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer slave. Lord, that's our confession this morning. I am of God. I am no longer a slave to fear,
cause I am a child.
I am
a child of God.
Lord, that's our declaration today, that you have not given us a spirit of fear, but love, power, and soundness of mind. You said that we shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon us, and we shall be witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the end of the earth. Let your power fall upon us in this house this morning. Let the power, O God, that raised Christ from the dead be made manifest in every heart and in every life seated here today. Let the hand of God be released upon your people. May God break the shackles of fear around you. May God destroy the chains of darkness around you. May God break down those yokes of poverty around you. May you begin to experience the liberation that comes from God's presence. The Bible says, where the Spirit of God is, there is liberty. Today, I speak liberty into your life. Lift your hands to God. Oh, shalalabahali kebrandolobo. Lord, we appropriate power this morning. we receive the grace of God to move us into a realm of faith and glory and power and authority. We will not be held back by the enemy. We will not be held back by our own fears. But we will step into a season of faith and trust. We embrace change in this season. Glory and honor to you, O God. Hallelujah. Come on, give God praise. Someone shout hallelujah. So Jesus said, we shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon us. I think it was 2 weeks ago, I was talking about the power to be a witness. Jesus said, let your light so shine before men. We're called to shine the light of the world. It's an amazing thing when Jesus said, He is the light of the world. But it's more amazing when He tells us that we are the light of the world. And that's what makes this church very unique. What makes us very different is that we're called to lead. We're called to express the truth of the Word of God. We're called to make a difference. We're called to make an impact. We're grateful for crowds, but the truth is we're more grateful when God raises men and women who make a difference in the world. When there's darkness, the need is light. When there's poverty, the need is of people who can make a difference. And that's why today I want to encourage you so you become an encourager. I want to motivate you so you become a motivator. I want to inspire you so you become an inspiration wherever you go. And so I want to thank everyone in this present house for the way we've embraced the vision, especially when I began to travel. I remember when TPH started and as church began to grow, I would leave church and drive through the streets of Lagos. And what we saw on the streets was poverty. I saw kids selling, you know, gear and a car. You went into the neighborhoods, you saw men on drugs. Went into some other areas, you saw the commercial sex workers. And that used to break my heart. But yet, we had powerful services. So one day I thought, there must be more than just having a good service. And that's how the foundation was born. That's how Bethesda was born, where we helped kids on the street. That's how Genesis House was born, where we began to help women who were in brothels. At the time, we would preach to them, so we began to preach to the ladies. But we realized that we would preach, but they had to go back to the brothels. There's a day, remember the day, I told the story the day I was preaching, and the girls were all restless. This was like, God bless Nigeria. And when I said, why? They said, time is money. So we asked them, how much? So they calculated in the time how many sessions of businessmen they would have engaged. So we paid them 1,000 naira per hour to sit in church. So thereafter, we realized it was better to actually get them a hostel. And that's how Genesis House was born. And then as God Bless Nigeria kicked off, I really, really love God Bless Nigeria. I just felt, wow. One, God Bless Nigeria allowed me, it gave me the platform to reach out to men I would never have touched in terms of touching their lives before. And I became their father. And I found that many of these men were intelligent, but they were victims of their circumstances. Do you know, when God Bless Nigeria started, I used to go there every Sunday. I was pastoring God Bless Nigeria for 5 years. It was very difficult for me because I knew that God wanted me out on the field. But then a lady came and said, we want a pastor we can see every Sunday. I said, but the vision of this church is a little different. We have to be on the streets. That we need people who are faithful and loyal to the vision where the senior pastor moves around. And they're resident pastors. That's the vision God has given us. And we're looking for people who could work with that vision. She said, no, I need a place where I need to see the pastor. I said, then move around with me every Sunday. Come and spend some time in God Bless Nigeria. Well, she did for a while. Then she disappeared. She said, God Bless Nigeria is too hard. You know, it's a church. You have to take sunscreen with you when you're going to preach, you know. To cut a long story short, God Bless Nigeria was just so powerful. And we realized we needed a more formal program. And we set up House of Refuge. And these are the programs the foundation affiliated to the church has been running in the past 10, 15 years. It's been such a blessing. So I want to thank everyone who's been supporting that vision. Sometimes you don't know how much, you don't know how much your support, how far your support is going. So today I want to talk for a few minutes about House of Refuge. So there is a little brochure. Please, does everyone have this brochure? Yes. I did a course on drug rehabilitation a few weeks ago. It was really on policy, helping nations grapple with the whole concept of drug rehabilitation. If you read This Day yesterday and Guardian on, no, This Day on Friday, Guardian yesterday, there were features on drug addiction. That's what the world is talking about right now. And I was so glad to have come into this a while ago. But one of the challenges of drug rehabilitation is the concept of relapse. It breaks our hearts when you work with people, then after a few years, they go back on drugs. At this course, they were saying, have a 5-year relapse prevention program, stay with them. But honestly, that is so difficult. That is so time consuming and that is so expensive. The principle behind that is drug addiction. The world is seeing drug addiction now, not as a criminal issue, but more as a health issue. And they're seeing drug addiction as a chronic problem. Though you have chronic asthma and diabetes, things you manage for a long time is the way we need to begin to manage drug addicts. But the challenge is, it's a very expensive project, following people up. And people don't really care. People care about kids, they care about women, but it's like men, let them sort themselves out. And now what makes it worse is that there are many more women now on drugs and there's so many kids and students on drugs. So we wanted to show you a little video today of some of the challenges we face in working with the men we find on the streets. So let's watch this short clip on Sunday.
First time I came across heroin, I sniffed and I had a very sound sleep. I met a friend who introduced me to shooting. A junkie cannot maintain a job. A junkie cannot stay in the house. A junkie will remain on the streets. Because whenever he wants to satisfy his urge, he can do anything. I sleep in the joints. I do things I don't supposed to do. I collect from people I'm supposed to give. have lost the dignity. Life there when I was on the streets. I'm on substance, abuse substance, cocaine, heroin, cannabis, all that. I have a new life now, and I'm okay. And I can experience love from everybody around me.
Today, I'm very, 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 very happy. We, Pastor Tony Rappu, thank you very much. I will come and thank you in congregation, what you are doing in my family.
Tomorrow, for what I am seeing and the way I am now, is going to be great. Formerly, I can't take a book to read. I can't write because I lost the zeal for it. But now, I can take a book and read. I can write. I'm relaxed now. I can think normal. I'm looking good. Thank God for my life. Sent by God Bless Nigeria to youth with a mission in Port Harcourt. I was there for 2 years. I did my DTS, Discipleship Training School. I was about doing my SBS, that is a School of Biblical Study. I woke up that day, I was asked to go for my outreach in Okrika, to go to Eleme, where my school is, to go and collect money for our feeding. So when I collected the money, the temptation came. Then I find myself in the joint. Drug is a stronghold. It has a very powerful spiritual effect, which is beyond my capacity then. Pastor Tony Apu, please, I need your help. This present house, I'm begging everybody to have mercy on me. If I'm given this last opportunity, I won't mess up with it. I promise I will be a better person. Together with you and God, if I can overcome this, I will never go back again. I have learned my lesson in a hard way.
Well, this is what we find on the streets every day. Sometimes we think we have problems, but you know, the degrees of problems. I want to thank the group that's been working with me, the board of Freedom Foundation. Please, Pastor Balaji, Dr. Haka. Doctor, please join us. Please join us. Shola is our executive secretary of the foundation. Shola, please say something and quickly tell us who these people are and how the program runs.
Okay, good morning, church. Thank you very much for sort of even watching the video and being moved by it. I'd like to introduce the advisory board of House of Refuge. House of Refuge is the drug rehabilitation program of Freedom Foundation, where people like Sunday, men and women, are brought in to be detoxified and to go through a rehabilitation process. We also have with us the program director of House of Refuge, Dr. Ogon Dupo. I'd like to introduce her.
Good morning, church. I'm the program director of House of Refuge. I'm Dr. Ogon Nayan Dupo. I'm a psychiatrist by profession. House of Refuge is a project I have a particular interest in. Reasons being, over my years of practice as a psychiatrist, I have come to understand that addiction is something that could happen to anyone. Like Sunday said, it's truly a stronghold. It's not a function of really your social class. Being a bad parent doesn't necessarily, or being the best of parents doesn't necessarily mean your children are immune to addiction. But the whole idea behind addiction is people find themselves messed up in the wrong society, the wrong environment. So even the best child you have may turn out to be hooked on drugs. That's why I have decided to be a part of this project, because I believe we can touch lives, we can change lives. As a Christian, I believe I'm sowing to the work of God. That Sunday you save from the streets today may be your child's future you're saving somewhere. Yes, you're pulling someone from drug, and somewhere God is able to take care of your future, the future of your children, and they never get into drugs because you saved their life. Thank you.
Thank you. So what would you want us to do today? Let me talk to Ogo, the program manager for House of Refuge.
Good morning, church. Okay, the last set that we had at the residential rehab, we took in 6 patients. We would like to expand that because we don't understand that the problem is more than, you know, what we're seeing today. We want to expand it to have 15 to 20 patients. We really do need your help. The thrust of this fundraising drive today is for each person here, male or female, to partner with us with 10,000 naira a month, or 20,000, or 50,000, or 1 million, for 1 year. Because we believe that after 1 year, we would like to be self-funding, we hope. There are 2 parts to this program. There is the day one, and then there's the residential one. Today we're talking about the residential one. We would like to also expand the detoxification center, just to handle more than the 6 that we had. Thank you very much.
All right, let me ask the chairman, Pastor Balaji Onobolu, to say something.
Good morning, church. What I have to say is that, one, the video clip we saw depicts the real situation when you're dealing with rehabilitation. It's a 50-50 thing. But this would not discourage us, because for us, we don't count in percentages like you normally would count, or people would normally would count. We believe that one saved, rehabilitated drug addict off the streets will do more than you know, you would expect to happen. So it's not always 50, 10 people go in, 9 are okay, 1 is back. Relapse happens. That's number one. And you would be wondering, why do we need to still be part of this? My observation over time has been that the guys that are addicted usually are very, very brilliant and intelligent people. And it tells me one thing. These are men that otherwise would have been very strong men and women in society. But somewhere along the line, the enemy probably just spotted them and decided that he's going to keep these ones at bay and ensure that they do not get to where God wants them to be. I don't know how to explain it, but I know that it happens that way. So when I see these guys, I look at them more with a heart of compassion, because I see in them potentials that otherwise would have been. But unfortunately, these are lives that are about to be truncated. But thank God that we have the spirit and then we have the drive to get these men and women off the streets. So you'll be supporting us and helping us, making sure that that one man, that one woman, that one child, his destiny is not destroyed. Thank you very much.
So I want you to please clap for the board. So behind the scenes, the men and women who are actually working now, everyone can join the board. Everyone cannot be on the street, but everyone can be part of the whole process by giving just a little. So I want you to please bring out the pledge form, bring out the pamphlet, and tear out the pledge form and give. It could be 5, 10, 50, whatever the Lord lays on your heart. But what we truly want is consistent support. And Sunday is still on the streets, and you know, you never know what can happen next. We're hoping that if we get enough support, we will go get him this week. Is that a good idea? No one believes in that. Should we go get Sunday back? But it requires support. It requires support. It requires resources. It requires more detox, more medication. Someone has to pay fees for maybe some program, maybe accommodation. That's the work we're doing. But I think it's good work. So please, let's give to the work. Thank you. Thank you. Now, this place is even a bit more quiet now. Is it because of Sunday? Whenever God blesses my wife and I, I'd say to her, we have to help the poor. So the more I get blessed, the more I reach out to help the poor. The more God opens doors for me, the more I do things for those who are underserved. All right, please, how about those online? Shall I please speak to those online?
To those who are watching online, we strongly urge and invite you to please join us, partner with us, support us. You can learn more about Freedom Foundation by going to our website, www.freedomfoundationng.org. You can volunteer online. You can donate online. And same thing goes for everyone here. You can give directly to House of Refuge by writing a check or paying. We have an InterSwitch platform online, so you can also give online. Or you can give to any of the other programs as you are moved. But House of Refuge right now is not an easy program to raise for, because it's to do with addiction. But here we've been given a very unique and special mandate in the house to support this work. And so I really want everyone here to partner. We're really looking for 100 people who can give us that 10,000, 20,000 naira a month for 1 year. That'll sustain the program and keep us going. Thank you very much.
Good morning, church. Jesus thought that we were worth dying for. Like Sunday in the video, Sunday said, have mercy on me, TPH. God had mercy on us and sent his son to die for us. He thought that we were worth dying for. Is Sunday worth saving? Thank you. You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for, so you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I could be whole, so I could tell everyone I know.
So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I could be free. So I could be whole.
And words.
Saving us, dying for us. Use us, O God, in this dark world to bring light and life. In Jesus' name we pray. You may please be seated. Are you guys feeling on the side? It's still new, a little dark, so it's still work in progress. So I think we've got the stage going. We've got the choir to sit with you on the side. We will be moving the grand piano up and putting up more lights here, so it's one hall. Come on, let's put our hands together. I think it's in Mark 5:23. In Mark chapter 5, verse 23. In the NLT version, okay, in 22, Jesus was a man called Jairus, a local synagogue leader, whose name was Jairus, arrived. When he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet, pleading fervently, saying, "Please come and lay, my daughter is dying. Today, we're talking about House of Refuge, but honestly, we advertised my message as a tale of two women, and that's the message I have. But watching Sunday has really changed the atmosphere, and so I really feel like preaching a different message, but because we've prepared for Ruth and Naomi, I would speak a few words on what it is God wants us to do. And then move to the message we advertised. But the truth is, what Jairus said to Jesus is really the condition of the world today. The world is dying. He said, my child is dying. My daughter is dying. Systems are dying. Degradation everywhere. This last week was very difficult for many people. But the challenges are all over the world. A friend of ours from the States said to us last week, he said he talks to politicians and people in government, and they say to him that behind, when the cameras are not there, honestly, we don't know what to do. But what Jairus said is what God is saying to us, that the world is in a bad shape. You come and lay your hands so she can be healed and she can live. We are the answer to a dying world. We are the solution to a world that's in despair. But the challenge oftentimes is that we ourselves, who are called to be saviors of the world, haven't either understood or haven't been empowered. Ideally, you shouldn't stay in the place of incapacitation for too long. Once you're out of extreme paralyzing incapacitation, your work is to lay hands on a waiting world, on a dying world, and bring change. By your words, your deeds, your actions. That's our call. And the more God helps you, you should help save a dying world. The Bible says we are the salt of the earth. We make the world palatable. We preserve the world for God. Paul says, you are ambassadors of the kingdom. You are the light of the world. So my prayer for you is that you would come out of the place of your incapacitation and become a tool in the hands of God to save a dying world. Let me hear you say an amen. My prayer is that God will so bless you. How powerful it will be to be like Bill Gates, trying to eliminate malaria or tuberculosis from the world. How powerful to be that person who says, I'll take care of so-and-so number of drug addicts. I'll help get girls off the street. How powerful to be the one who says, I will build a house where we can bring many more people to teach them the ways of God. That's why this church exists, to empower, that we may empower others. Remember what I said a few Sundays ago, that you pass by degradation. It's asking, are you my savior? You walk past a drug addict, he's saying, can you help me? You don't have to hear Sunday speak on video. You walk past wires on the floor. You should say, who put these wires here? You flush a toilet, there's no water. You should ask, where can I get water from? Unfortunately, we're raising a people who don't understand that their call is to save the world. So when people ask me abroad, where is God? Where is God? When all this is happening, I'll say he's in the church. He's waiting for the church to rise up and do it. May God use you to bring change to a world that desperately needs change. But today, I'd like you to embrace change yourself so you can teach and change. And I find, you know, I come into a meeting, I find people really sad, gloomy, and what's the problem? Oh, fuel crisis, money, foreign exchange. I'm thinking, okay, these challenges are there, but these things present the very backdrop for your light to shine. So may God give you wisdom to be a Joseph in this season, to be a Daniel, to be a game changer. But let's talk about a woman called Ruth today. And let's see if we can learn one or two things from Ruth. I'm going to make it a short, sharp message just to inspire you to see what the future could hold in spite of your present circumstances.
So in Ruth chapter 1, Ruth is one of those scriptures that's difficult to, one of those books that's difficult to find. It's locked in somewhere between Judges and 1 Samuel. Pastor Dell, please can you read Ruth for me, please?
Ruth chapter 1, verse 1. Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to dwell in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech. The name of his wife was Naomi. And the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem, Judah. And they went to the country of Moab and remained there. Then Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left and her two sons. Now they took wives of the women of Moab. The name of one was Orpah, and the name of the other Ruth. And they dwelt there about 10 years. Then both Mahlon and Chilion also died. So the woman survived her two sons and her husband. Then she arose with her daughters-in-law that she might return from the country of Moab. For she had heard in the country of Moab that the Lord had visited his people by giving them bread. Therefore, she went out from the place where she was and her two daughters-in-law with her. And they went on the way to return to the land of Judah. And Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go, return each to her mother's house. The Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you may find rest each in the house of her husband." So she kissed them, and they lifted up their voices and wept. And they said to her, "Surely we will return with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Are there still sons in my womb that they may be your husbands? Turn back, my daughters. Go, for I am too old to have a husband. If I should say I have hope, if I should have a husband tonight and should also bear sons, would you wait for them till they are grown? Would you restrain yourselves from having husbands? No, my daughters, for it grieves me very much for your sakes that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me." Then they lifted up their voices and wept again. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. And she said, "Look, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law." But Ruth said, "Entreat me not to leave you or to turn back from following after you. For wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people and your God my God. Where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me and more also, if anything but death parts you
please read on
and
to 22.
When she saw that she was determined to go with her, she stopped speaking to her. Now the two of them went until they came to Bethlehem. And it happened when they had come to Bethlehem that all the city was excited because of them. And the women said, "Is this Naomi?" But she said to them, "Do not call me Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, and the Lord has brought me home again empty. Why do you call me Naomi, since the Lord has testified against me, and the Almighty has afflicted me?" So Naomi returned, and Ruth, the Moabitess daughter-in-law, with her, who returned from the country of Moab. Now they came to Bethlehem at the beginning of the barley harvest.
Thank you, Pastor Dell. How about, please go to Matthew chapter 1, maybe from the NIV version, please, from verse 3. Let's start from verse 1. Verse 1,
okay.
2.
This is the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac. Isaac, the father of Jacob. Jacob, the father of Judah and his brothers. Judah, the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar. Perez was the father of Hezron. Hezron, the father of Ram. Ram, the father of Amminadab. Amminadab, the father of Nashon. Nashon, the father of Salmon. Salmon, the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. Boaz, the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth. Obed, the father of Jesse. And Jesse, the father of King David. David was the father of Solomon, whose mother had been Uriah's wife.
All right, thank you. Well, in the story this morning, we see the unfolding of a tragedy. We see a drama with some very unhappy events. A man called Elimelech, married to a woman called Naomi, living in Bethlehem in Israel. We're going through challenging times, and he thought, let me move out of Israel for this season and relocate to the neighboring country of Moab. And so him, his wife, and their two sons moved to Moab. And in Moab, the two sons get married to two beautiful Moabite women, one called Orpah and the other called Ruth. But over time, the man Elimelech dies. Heartbreaking. But not only did Elimelech die, his two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, also pass away. And we end up with three widows living in the land of Moab. And after this series of very unhappy events, Naomi is heartbroken and thinks, I better just return to my home country. Calls her two daughters-in-law and says to them, it's been tough, girls. It's really been hard. I'm going back, and I suggest you both go back too. Orpah says, Naomi, thank you for releasing me. I'm going back. But Ruth, and that's my message this morning, is the woman of destiny. She makes a profound statement, something that people have preached over and over again. She makes a declaration. It's like a proclamation of her commitment, not just to Naomi, but a commitment to purpose. She said, you don't understand. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people. And I've recognized that your God is Jehovah. He also shall be my God. So we're looking at a woman this morning who's standing on the threshold of her destiny. She is severely disadvantaged. She's mourning. Her husband is dead. Her brother-in-law, her husband's brother, is dead. Her father-in-law has also passed on. Her sister-in-law, best friend and confidant, is also mourning and going back to her own gods and her own family. And here is her husband's mom, her own mother-in-law, saying, why don't you also go back? She's alone. Moab has been one tragedy after the other. And we do not read of any children to really take care of her. Her past has no encouraging circumstance at all. Her present has nothing motivating. There's no motivation around her. Yet, if you read the story with the benefit of hindsight, we know that when they returned, there was rejoicing. We know that they came back at the time of a harvest. And from reading the book of Matthew, this lady actually ends up in the lineage of Jesus Christ and becomes the grandmother of King David. What's my message today? Destiny is calling. I hear destiny beckoning. I don't really have a message today after watching Sunday. What I have is a call to someone to go beyond the place of your disadvantage and embrace your destiny. Who could have imagined that Ruth would meet a Boaz and Ruth would become the grandmother of King David and then end up in the genealogy of David? Who could have imagined it? Who could have seen it? Who could have known it? Today I've come to announce that there's something in the air. Those situations and circumstances may seem disadvantaged. As I've been saying, when all of Israel was weeping and crying over the issue of Goliath, there was a man who recognized opportunity in the midst of the distress. And so Goliath became a door, a knock on the door of David's destiny. And even Naomi, but I'm not going to talk about Naomi today. God was moving Naomi into a season of mentorship, which is the message I have for the women at the next breakfast meeting. The message of the preparation of Naomi for mentoring a younger lady who was now supposed to be the grandmother of David. Now we have the benefit of hindsight. We have the benefit of the prophetic. Something is about to happen in the realm of the spirit. And I've come to tell you today that your future depends on you. Oh, we usually say God is in control, and he is. But God cannot impose success on you. It depends on you. God cannot force you to be a winner. You've got to want to win for yourself. And people are afraid of the devil. Ah, the devil is raging. Yes, he is. But the truth is, the devil cannot impose failure on you. On Wednesday, Shegun Baje, who spoke, said, Nigeria is an open canvas waiting for a great painting. I said it a few weeks ago also, that Nigeria is raw material in the hands of those who know how to bring refinement. As I speak this morning, I want to tell you that there's no curse, no divination, no enchantment that should stop you from fulfilling your destiny. When we preach on purpose, we said concerning David in Acts 13:36 that David served God's purpose. He didn't serve his own purpose. NIV version. He served God's purpose. My prayer for you is that you will serve God's purpose in your generation. Because if you do not know God's purpose for your life, no one can tell you. So we hear Ruth lifting her voice and telling her mother-in-law, Naomi, I've heard you. I've heard you, but I know what I am doing. And we can hear the determination in her voice, the sense of purpose, the tenacity, the perseverance. I know what I'm doing. I'm coming with you. I'm coming with you. So here's a lady who rose up from the ashes of her pain and embraced her destiny. Here's a woman who laid hold of her future and received beautiful ashes. So often you're waiting for, people are waiting for someone to encourage them. If you're waiting for someone to encourage you, you might wait forever. You've got to learn how to encourage yourself. The Bible says, David, encourage himself in the Lord. You've got to learn how to lift your hands and be encouraged. If everyone is in distress, then who's going to save the world? And so God is looking for saviors. Obadiah says, saviors will come to Mount Zion. You are the saviors. Jesus was our savior. But after Jesus did his work, now he's raising saviors. Obadiah. PK, give me that scripture, please. What's that scripture? Savior shall come to Mount Zion. My message today is very simple. You are a savior. You are God's transformer. You are God's conduit pipe. You are God's generator. You bring light. The NIV version says, saviors come to Mount Zion, deliverers. So you are a deliverer. You are a savior. But today, may you be delivered, that you become a deliverer. If you're waiting for the environment to be perfect, remember, I say it over and over again, you don't move out because the environment is perfect. You move out because you carry something within you. Oh, may God heal someone here today so they themselves become healers. May God bless someone here today so you become a blessing. May God enable you today so you become an enabler. Remember the story of the four leprous men who sat at the gates of Samaria. There was war in the city. There was war outside. There was famine everywhere. But God had something in mind. There were prophecies hanging in the air. And God was only waiting for a people who could rise up. And here were these men, no limbs, shuffling on the ground. And they said, are we going to sit here till we die? And they made a move. That move they made released destiny. That move they made caused something to happen in the realm of the spirit. I've come to ask you, is there something God wants you to do in this season? Is there a call you should hearken to? Is there a change? Is there change you should make somewhere? Is there some alignment you need to get into so you can find yourself where God wants you? Is there something you ought to be doing in your marriage, in your family, that in a sense brings God's purpose into your life? Wherever you go, I will go. That was that woman embracing her destiny. Can you embrace your destiny? These days online, you find people using all sorts of terms, but sometimes they're motivational. So make this April an amazing April. Make May a marvelous May. Make Monday magical. Make every day Christmas. Don't wait for the conditions to be right. Ruth didn't wait. Ruth said, Naomi, I'm coming with you. I've never been to Israel before. I've lived in Moab all of my life. But why go back to my past? I'm prepared for something new. I'm prepared to enter into something fresh. I want something powerful. Do you know, people love the familiar. And it's the natural tendency of humans to resist change. If you go to a franchise, maybe you go to a McDonald's. I went to a McDonald's in Trinidad years ago. I was surprised. It reminded me of the McDonald's on Oxford Street in London. I thought, wow, it's exactly the same. The bathroom, everything was the same. Why? The owners know what they're doing. They want to make their customers feel comfortable. They want you to be relaxed. They want you to feel, I've been here before. Because it is natural to pursue things that you're familiar with. The reason why people resist change is that comfort, when you're comfortable, it reduces the stress of decision making. Unlike when you have to deal with crisis and change, you've got to be sharp on your feet. But if God wants to move you to a new season, He's got to bring change around you. And so today I'm urging you to embrace change. Embrace something new. I went to a conference years ago. It had 23 nations at the conference. And so the conveners said, please make sure you meet someone from a different nation. Go introduce yourself. You know, go and talk to someone. And so we were greeting people from Venezuela, from South America, from Mexico, from Asia. Do you know, after a while, I thought, let me just look for some Nigerians and calm my head down. Isn't it what most people want to do? You're comfortable with your own. You don't have to work hard to embrace the challenges that change would bring. But do you know that people are paid at parties to talk to people, to make a party happen? Because what makes a party happen is the level of interaction that goes on amongst people. And that's highly prized. But ordinary people want to stay safe. Ordinary people want to just take calculated steps where there is no risk in life. But today I'm talking about a woman who was extraordinary, Ruth. And no one here is also supposed to be ordinary. Do you know, as a Christian, you're not ordinary. Look at the stars. Look at the creativity of the planets. Look at the diversity of flora, of fauna, of birds and animals. Look at the diversity of creation. And then you come to God's ultimate creation, the Christian, and you see repetition, boredom, and stagnation. That's not God. We are God's ultimate. Ephesians 2:10 says, we are God's workmanship. That means God is a workman. We are the outworking of what He did. And we are created for good works in Christ Jesus. May you see yourself as God sees you. So Christianity is not a religion. We did not get born again to go to church. Christianity is an art. It's the art of living. Christianity is how humans should exist on the face of the earth. Christianity is the JD, the job description of a winner. Christianity is the lifestyle of an overcomer. Does it mean things are going to be easy? No, not at all. I'm sure you've heard the way in which the mother eagle teaches the baby eagles to fly is to tip them out of the nest and then hovers around them so that they can fly. And there are times when God wants you out of the nest. So God can be like a mother eagle. Sometimes He roughens the nest so you become uncomfortable. Why? It's uncomfortable people who create change in every generation. It's uncomfortable people who create new trends. It is uncomfortable people who become pioneers. They just cannot cope with the status quo. They just sort of feel there must be more. And for years, I've been preaching the concept of holy dissatisfaction. You get to a place where I'm dissatisfied. But it's holy because it's God making you feel, you know, pressed in, making you feel hemmed in, making you feel... There's one song we used to sing when I was a DJ. I feel like busting loose. Remember, I feel like busting loose by a guy called Chuck Someone. That's what the sons of the prophet said when they came to Elisha. They said, do you know that the place we dwell is a bit too small for us? I'm beginning to feel the same way around me. And that's how I feel. I'd come home for a season, preach in church, then I begin to feel caged. I begin to feel I've got to go out there and speak to someone. I've got to go out there and build someone that impacts more people. I've got to go out there and support some more people. That's how I feel often, that there is more God wants me to do. If you're feeling sort of oppressed and uncomfortable, then God is saying, it's your time. It's your time. It's your time to embrace change. If you're feeling stagnant, then God is saying, it's time to lift your wings and fly. And Ruth was willing to leave the familiar, even though it meant some discomfort. She was willing to leave the family, even though it meant some uncertainty. She was willing to leave that which was used to, even though it meant some relocation and possibly disconnection from the people she had known. But these are little when it comes to embracing what the future has for you. You know how sometimes a father or a grandfather is playing with the kids and goes and hides behind the curtain? What is the purpose of that game? Is it so the child, the toddler, doesn't find the father? No. It's that the whole idea of the game is to locate the man who's hiding. That's how God is. And there are times when it seems like you're getting, the child wants to get discouraged and leave the game. Father says, cook, make some noise to sort of inspire the child and say, I'm here. Don't give up. That's what God is doing for us today. Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't throw in the towel. Don't be a quitter. Don't be a loser. You're designed, as I keep saying, you're programmed, pre-programmed, wired to succeed, wired to lead, wired to overcome. You're created to lead. You're designed to govern. That's why we're in Christ. That's the revelation God has given us for 20 years. We're not designed to go to church. We only come to church to be inspired, to receive wisdom, to receive know-how, and to go out there and be loosed to a waiting world. To enter greatness, God must needs bring you through a season of change. And sometimes you may need to disconnect from people. If that's what God is saying, disconnect. There are some relationships that you cannot take into the chapters of your future. Not everyone you grew up with would follow you into your destiny. So recognize your yesterday people. Appreciate them for the role they played in your life, for the grace they brought into your life. But when it's time to move on, you need to learn how to say bye-bye and walk away. You need to learn that when you walk with God, there are certain demands He places on you. And disconnection from people is one of them. A rocket that's flying to a new realm sometimes has to drop off some parts so it can soar into outer space. There are times you need to drop some things so you can move into the next level. When Moses was called by God, he was in the palace. He thought it was in the palace that God would bring change and make him a deliverer. But God had change in mind in a different way. He was in the wilderness, away from the palace, that he saw a burning bush. Who could have imagined that there in the wilderness, he would have a burning bush experience? But that's the way of God. How about Daniel? Was it not in the captivity of Babylon that his own gifts began to flourish? He embraced change to come into greatness. How about Joseph, the man who had dreams? Was it not in Egypt, far away? Have you ever seen God do things in a straight line? Have you not always embraced or seen the poetry of God working mysteries, working in ways you cannot fathom? But every step you take, it's towards the unfolding of your destiny. That's what makes Christianity so exciting. Pastor Kay was talking about it the other day, saying, who could have imagined that you come into a place where your purpose, your God's purpose for your life came into a place where you were in government? But therein lies the hand of God, moving people one step at a time into His purpose. And there's still so much ahead for you, man of God. The Lord wants you to be encouraged at this time. The Lord wants you to be encouraged that there's yet, as you know, things ahead of you. Things He's spoken to you. Things He's bringing you into. But all He requires is your tenacity, like Ruth, to say, Lord, I've seen the path. I'm stepping into it. I will stand in it. I will pursue my purpose in you. And that's the same to everyone here. It's a time to step out. Never let the environment condition you. You're bigger on the inside than all of the outside. Greater is He that's in you than he that's in the world. You're bigger than all of heaven. All of heaven dwells on your inside. You're stronger than your surrounding. You're stronger than your circumstances. You are stronger than whatever situation is going on around you. You're a survivor. You can make it. We don't succeed because there are no challenges. We succeed because we're strong. So people sometimes see pastors and think we're not going through problems. Oh, excuse me. For many people, wherever you are coming, where you are heading towards in terms of your problem, I'm coming from there. I've seen the problems of life. But we just keep moving because we know Him whom we have believed. God is calling someone to move into the next level. In Genesis 12, verse 1, God wanted to bless Abraham. He said, Abraham, I want to bless you, but you've got to come out of your country. Get out from your father's house to a land I will show you. And Abraham went, the Bible says in Hebrews, not knowing, but he knew he was pursuing destiny. How often times God says, make a move, give an offering, do something powerful, but you want to check it out. God says, jump with 2 feet. You want to test if the water would carry you. Today I've come to encourage someone. I've come to inspire faith in your heart to move into that next level where you become a deliverer, where you become a savior. And guess what? New levels, new devils. At that level, there'll be some challenges also. Remember that old story about the pastor who laid hands on a man and said, I pray that God will take you from victory to victory. He said, no, pastor, no. One victory. Pastor was saying victory to victory. He said, pastor said, why? He said, pastor, victory to victory means trouble to trouble. But that's the truth. But does He not give you grace? When the going gets tough, the tough get going. When the going gets rough, the tough get rough. No, someone said, when the going gets tough, the tough get going. When the going gets rough, the tough give it to Jesus. There's something on your inside. There's something you carry. Abraham was blessed only as he moved. There was a man called Philip. We don't talk about him much. Philip was a man who raised a revival in the city of Samaria. Bible says there was a revival. Do you know, in the midst of the revival, he didn't stay. God moved him out to a little village, to the desert, and God was arranging divine connection. Sometimes we hold on to success. Meanwhile, God has something in store beyond the success. I think there's something in the spirit that God is doing. God is speaking to someone today, asking you to change. Change in the season will reposition you for supernatural revelation. Change in the season will reposition you for supernatural promotion. Change will bring you into the place of innovation. Change causes you to look for fresh ideas. And the signature of God, the trademark of heaven, anything that has a stamp made in heaven is fresh. And God uses change to bring you freshness. God is a God of change. Even though He says, I am the Lord, I do not change.
Even though Hebrews says Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever, God changes his ways. He changes his methods. He changes his strategies. He changes his patterns. I feel that God is already positioning some people, but they cannot see what he's doing. God is a God of newness. I just sense God saying, behold, I do a new thing. Isaiah 43 verse 19 says, I do a new thing. I want to prophesy to someone that scripture. May God do a new thing in your life. Now it springs forth. Oh God, let there be a springing forth. May God make a road for you in the wilderness. May he make, let me hear you say an amen. May he make rivers for you in the desert. God is the God of newness. The Bible says even his mercies, that's Lamentation 3:23. His mercies are new every morning. So he's the God of the new. The Bible says, sing unto the Lord a new song. David said, he has put a new song in my mouth. These signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They speak with new tongues. What kind of tongues are you speaking? Old tongues. Can you upgrade your tongues, please? Please upgrade your tongues. God does a new thing every day. Even God himself has a new testament. He loves new wine. He loves new wineskins. If any man is in Christ, he is a new creation. Not an old creation. Paul said, put on the new man. That's Ephesians 4:24. Put on the new man or the new woman, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. The people here that God is repositioning. I feel it. I sense it. I know it. The reason why Jesus came to the world was to bring life. But the life came with change. The only people who did not like change are the Pharisees. Religious people do not like change. So Jesus spoke to women. They got offended. He went to a party with Matthew, who was a tax collector. Matthew's friends were funny people. But Jesus was out there. Guess who was outside? Who was outside hissing the Pharisees? They said he's eating with sinners. They did not know that he carried the life to the sinners. He ate with unwashed hands. They complained. He sat in the house of a man. A woman came and was washing, rubbing her hair on his feet. They said she's a sinner. God's ways, clearly not our ways. Let me round up this message by saying, is there an area of your life that God is calling you to change? Do you know when Jesus came, do you know he did not go to church to look for disciples? I'll tell you why. Because in the synagogue, after a while, comes a traditional mind. He went to the streets. He went to the area boys. He went to the prostitutes. He went to the fishermen. People who could take risks. People who could step out. People who could love because they had been loved. People who could forgive because they had been forgiven. Is there an area of your life God may be saying, change? Is there something he's calling you to disconnect from that you might cherish? But he's saying, I need you to shut it down because change has come. Maybe it's time to change the way you worship. Maybe you are stuck with the same old songs you sang 10, 20 years ago. And all you do is complain about the new songs. Maybe that's where the anointing is. Maybe you're one of those who you don't believe in lifting hands up. Yes, the Bible says lift your hands to God. Maybe you should change the way you pray. Maybe you're one of those who pray quietly. God is saying, lift your voice.
Or maybe you shout and God is saying, have a quiet time in my presence. Please tell the person next to you, I think change has come. Change! And it could be simple things like changing your perfume. God could be in that detail. I was preaching in a church in Croydon in the UK, preaching this message, and just joking, I said, Rosemary, change your hairstyle. Do you know, after service, they pulled Rosemary to me. They said, we've told her to get rid of these braids. I said, I was just joking. I didn't know they've been telling you to remove your braids, Rosemary, but maybe you should remove those braids. How long have you had them? She said, 6 months. I said, it's too long. Someone said, change. Maybe you need to change. Do you know, you perhaps need to change the way you see God. Do you know, sometimes you ask people, how are you doing? Oh, God is teaching me this. God is teaching me that. That's good. But do you know, God is not always a teacher. Sometimes he's a father and just wants to hug you and love you and enjoy you in his presence. He's not always a judge. He's not always punishing. Change the way you think. That was my take-home scripture this morning. In Numbers 14, when God was talking about Caleb. Numbers 14, please. He said, but my servant Caleb has a different attitude. Please tell someone, change your attitude. Do you know God cares about your attitude? He does. He said Caleb has a different attitude. Some people, once you're in their presence, trouble, hissing, complains. Change your attitude. Be positive about life. See things differently. See people differently. See the best in people. Stop criticizing. Stop criticizing. Stop everything you do is criticize. Why don't you make a difference? Change your attitude. It could be to change your wardrobe. Change the way you look. And we're not changing for the sake of change. We're changing because God is saying change is bringing us into a season of his presence, of his power. There's a Chinese restaurant we go to, and the lady sent us, you know, the same things everyone eats, you know. What is it? Spring rolls and beef, shredded beef. And Chapman. So I said, send us something different. So one day she sent something. I said, what's this? She said, you asked for something different. It is seaweed. I said, okay, we have to eat it. I was in my barber shop one day. I said to him, let's give me a different hairstyle today. Now I'm, you know, give me a different hairstyle. And I think I must have dozed off while I was cutting my hair. Went up my hair. All my hair was gone. I said, I didn't say to give me. He said, you asked for something new. I had to stay away for a week or two until my hair, like Samson's, grew up again. Change the way you treat your wife. Speak politely to your wife. Sometimes, open the car door for your wife. Sometimes men change your baby's nappies. No one said anything. What's wrong in giving your wife a break? Why can't you? Sometimes wash the dishes, man. Change the rules. Once there's a, once, you know how men are. When your kids are doing well, you feel, yes, I brought him up well. When there's trouble, where's your mother? Go to your mommy. Why don't you do homework sometime for the kids? Why don't you come back on time and help kids do homework, man? Come on, let's have kingdom men changing the way we live. Only the women said yes, so. Incredible doors are awaiting those who can embrace this concept of change. You might have to change your job. You might have to change your job to move into the next season. And it might involve moving, so move. It might involve traveling, so travel. I feel there are new partnerships waiting here today. Go do a course in IT. Go get a new home. We're changing because God is preparing us for something. We're preparing today for the future of tomorrow. Once you adapt to the present, you kill the future. Don't accept the present. One problem in the life of Abraham was that he thought he had to stay with Lot. Lot was his nephew. He felt, oh, Lot is the one nephew I have to take care of. But it was when Abraham separated from Lot, God then said in blessing, I will bless you. I want to prophesy to you this week that there are new associations coming your way. I want to speak into your life about a concept called a Cornelius connection. A Cornelius connection is when Cornelius and Peter meet and a whole new world opens up. I speak Cornelius connections. As you take steps of faith this week, may supernatural doors begin to open to you. I see new businesses. I see new businesses starting out. I see your Boaz. I pray for those men and women who are believing God for partners. May God, as He ordered the steps of Naomi, order your steps so that you meet your Boaz, or your Boaz, your Ruth comes alongside you. Like Naomi, may you be a person repositioned to move into a season where God uses you in a different way. Perhaps some of you need to begin to serve God. You've never served God before. Then maybe this is the time to serve. Perhaps you can open your home for the Be At One program. That's different. Do something different. Give up your home. Some of us have never taken risks in giving gifts. You can afford it. You can renovate the house of refuge, but you choose not to. You can pay for 10 drug addicts, but you choose not to. On the 24th, we want to go back to building. God has spoken to my heart. I wasn't here on the 24th, but I want to stay here on the 24th so we can commission the new building. God is saying that building is a platform to express His glory in our lives. That when God gives a building, when God gives people a building, some people say we've been building. Well, in this house, that building is the instrumentality that God wants to use to bring the resources of heaven into your pockets.